The Sahara Desert is one of the world's most unfavorable environments for human life. No rain and clouds, intense thermal radiation that is dangerous to the body, temperatures that are consistently above 40 degrees Celsius during the summer months, and even higher in certain regions, are just a few of the reasons why a person couldn't stand this kind of environment. There are also gigantic dust storms that occur at any time, and are packed with billions of superheated small sand particles that can damage your body, eyes, and throat if breathed in. It's no surprise that, despite its enormous size, it only has a population of 2.5 million people, making it one of the world's emptiest landmasses. Without a doubt, it would really be difficult to find someone to help you if you happen to be stranded there. However, you must believe me when I say that a man named Mauro Prosperi managed to survive for 9 extremely painful days in the Sahara, given the circumstances I stated previously. And his story of how he was able to make it out alive goes something like this. The so-called Marathon des Sables was founded in 1986, and many consider it to be the most arduous and physically difficult race ever. The ultramarathon takes place entirely within the Sahara Desert in southeastern Morocco, covering around 251 kilometers over the span of 6 extremely difficult days. Aside from the vast distance, the marathon participants had to battle the Sahara's extreme heat, isolation, and incredibly challenging terrain. It was in 1994 that Italian Mauro Prosperi, then 39 years old, decided to participate in the ultramarathon. Take note that at the time, he was already an experienced runner, and had already won multiple gold medals. He was in the race with 80 other people, but considering the vastness of the Sahara, that number is insignificant, so they all run alone for most of the race, along a predefined and marked trail. This meant that everyone had to rely on themselves most of the time. Prosperi brought a backpack with extra food, clothing, a sleeping bag, a compass, a portable stove, and an emergency kit, with one signal flare in case he became separated from the others. At prearranged stations along the route, each runner was given water. The Marathon des Sables is divided into 6 stages that will take 6 days to finish. Prosperi ran 18 miles on the first day, 22 miles on the second day, and another 25 miles on the third day. His fourth day in the marathon was difficult because he had to traverse more than 53 miles in less than 24 hours. On this day, he was still doing well in the race, finishing in fourth position overall. He was, however, running alone when the temperature reached 46 degrees Celsius. The scorching heat raised the temperature of the surface air, causing swirling winds to develop into a sandstorm. When the wind began to come close to him while he was running, he decided to cut over the smaller sand dunes to speed up. However, as he did so, the wind grew stronger and picked up more and more sand, eventually developing into a severe level sandstorm that blurred his vision. He had to decide whether or not to stay put and wait for the storm to pass. Yet, he was concerned that if he did, he would lose in the race. Furthermore, he was terrified about being buried alive in the sandstorm. With that, he decided to keep running to what he thought was the correct trail in order to keep his strong lead in the race. Prosperi had to keep running for more than 8 hours until the sandstorm stopped. He had no choice but to breathe in the air, which had become packed with millions of fast-moving, razor-sharp sand grains. Because of this, his nose and mouth were bleeding intensely. When he was able to see clearly after the sandstorm stopped, he saw that the race trail couldn't be found anywhere. Prosperi, on the other hand, seemed to be unaware of how awful his situation had gotten. He merely spread out his sleeping bag on the desert floor, covered his face with a towel, and dozed off. He proceeded to run for another 4 hours after waking up the next morning, hoping to meet paths with someone else on the race. But he didn't. He then climbed a big sand dune, and what he saw terrified him. There was nothing in the entire area. He had also spent about 24 hours without stopping at the race checkpoint to refill his water bottle, and he had very little left. This is when he realized how bad the situation was, that he automatically urinated in his spare water bottle to be able to recycle his fluids. Following race rules, he remained still for hours while waiting for a race helicopter to come help him. The moment he noticed a lone, low-flying chopper approaching his location, he hastily reached into his backpack and launched the single flare he had with him. The helicopter, however, was unable to see him because he was only able to create a faint signal flare, so it continued to fly directly above him until it disappeared over the horizon. Prosperi went to sleep because of his tremendous disappointment. The next day, his second day of being alone in the Sahara, he was still battling with the intense temperatures ranging around 40 degrees Celsius. He was concerned that if he remained in place any longer, he might collapse due to severe heat stroke. He tried to use a compass to figure out where he was, but there was just sand in every direction. Despite the fact that he had no idea where to go, he began walking. He discovered a long-abandoned Bedouin Muslim shrine after several hours, where he stayed for the following 2 days, hoping that someone would come to his aid. During these 2 days, he cooked the food left on his portable burner using his fresh urine. He was drinking his own urine to keep himself hydrated, in addition to sucking wet wipes and licking dews off rocks. He placed a small Italian flag on top of the shrine in the hopes of drawing attention to himself or serving as a guide to locate where he is, as if he died. He spotted an airplane flying past just above his location on his 4th day. Prosperi hastily drew the SOS symbol in the sand, and in his desire to be rescued, he set fire to his backpack to make a smoke signal, since he'd run out of signal flares. But as soon as he set fire to his own backpack, another terrible sandstorm blew across the area, this time lasting over 12 hours. As a result, the plane missed him, and he remained stranded. He had lost hope after failing to be rescued twice, and he was now certain that he would suffer a terrible and painful death inside the shrine. He wanted to die inside the shrine because he was scared that if he died while walking in the desert, no one would be able to find him, which would be horrible for his wife back home. In Italy, if someone goes missing without a body being found, they must wait 10 years before they can legally be declared dead. If he died in the desert, his wife would wait for a decade to get his police pension. Prosperi decided to take his own life inside the shrine to help his wife. He cut his wrists with a small pocket knife after writing a farewell message and laying down, anticipating his death. Surprisingly, he awoke the next day with only minor blood on his wrists. Well, this is because the blood in his veins had simply clotted instead of freely flowing out due to his extreme dehydration. He suddenly became determined to live after waking up alive. He then packed his things and he went out of the shrine and decided to go to the chain of mountains he spotted. He only walked in the desert when it was much cooler, and he always walked in the direction of the mountains that seemed to be growing bigger as he got closer. He arrived at an oasis with a puddle of water amidst the sandy abyss for more than 3 days of walking toward the mountains. He ran over to drink it, but his throat and mouth were swollen to the point where he couldn't swallow owing to the near-fatal dehydration he was now feeling. He laid down for hours alongside the puddle, slowly sipping as much as he could with his hands. He slept right next to the puddle at night. He filled up his water container the next morning, his 9th day alone in the desert, and started walking in the direction of the mountains. He discovered fresh goat feces after several hours of traveling. He followed this path until he was able to find fresh human footprints in the sand. He saw a little girl alone with some goats as he followed the trail. This was the first person he had seen in nearly 10 days since he drifted away from the race. To his surprise, he ran toward the girl and pleaded for aid, but this scared the girl, and she ran. Prosperi chased her and reached the place where the nomadic Tuareg people stayed in. Then, Prosperi was finally rescued by a patrol of the local military police. Prosperi later discovered he was no longer in Morocco, but rather in Algeria. That means he unintentionally crossed the border and was 180 kilometers off the racing track. That's the equivalent of running a marathon in New York City and getting so lost that you end up in Boston by accident. Due to this exceedingly difficult to survive experience, Prosperi had dropped 33 pounds. Additionally, he needed 16 liters of intravenous fluids to fill the needed water in his body. His liver was severely injured and he could only eat soft food for months. His kidneys were permanently damaged due to the excessive urine he had no choice but to consume. His recovery from everything he'd experienced took nearly 2 years. Mauro Prosperi, on the other hand, wasn't discouraged from returning to the race. In fact, he competed in the same marathon 6 different times, placing 13th in 2001. In 2020, 7 years after his near-death incident, he published a book titled 10 Days Beyond Life. an Italian language book documenting his entire experience stranded alone in the Sahara Desert. What do you feel about Mauro Prosperi's story? Tell us in the comments section. If you enjoyed this video, give it a thumbs up, and don't forget to subscribe to the channel. Please click the bell icon so you'll be notified when new videos are posted. And as always, thanks for watching Ponder This.